You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back, and this is The Individual in Society. My name is Sergio Soto, and this is our, eighth broadcast. And our topic today will focus on stratification, class. For the most part, we're going to talk about our economy and how that influences an individual's life. And we'll also talk about the inequalities that are structured inside. Now, before we really get started, I'll go over three questions that came in during the week. We don't have enough time to go through all of them, but these are three that I think would be, they're a little bit, diverse. So we'll read them off. Angelina wrote in the video that shows gender expression, is it because of norms within society that boys should not dress up like girls? Why do people call children who like to dress to wear clothes of the opposite gender gay or transgender? So we'll speak about speak to the first part of the question. So in short, yes, because of the norms inside society, it is deviant for a boy to dress in clothing that is coded for girls. Now, remember, when we talk about deviance, it's not about what's right or what's wrong, right? As the term deviance goes, but it's speaking to the violation of the norm in place, whether it's showing up late to class or being born male and choosing to wear a dress, that is deviance. Are people challenging it? Of course, right? And, yes, it's because of the norms. If, maybe in a few decades or maybe in a shorter amount of time, these gender norms will be challenged and will change and have changed, right? Some of you wrote about this in your paper, and you probably got a high score. You wrote about how our text talks about, at the turn of the century, boys or girls, or when they were babies, they were dressed in frilly, dress-like clothing. Colors, like the color pink that's gendered feminine, used to be, I don't know if this is in your text, but this it used to be exclusively male. You could see pictures of men wearing pink, sometimes royalty. Same thing with purple. Purple was often reserved just for people of power or people with, a lot of wealth. But the point is that they're changing. I think one of you wrote about how about skinny jeans, right? Skinny jeans are pretty popular. Not too long ago, they may have been seen as effeminate, feminine, right? Or not of, for males to wear. But the whole point is that these are norms, these are ideas about behavior, and yes, when they become violated, they are deviant, and it is how society measures it. And again, across societies around the world, it can vary. Now, with the second part, why do people call children who wear clothes of the opposite gender gay or transgender? Before we get into whether it's gay or transgender, what we're going to do is clarify that, you have to understand that And you know, this is hopefully something you're all understanding already, is that you know, we're talking about expectations here. So when we see each other, you know, out in the physical spaces that we, you know, live in every day, you know, there's coding everywhere. You know, we conform to expectations, or we have expectations about not only how daily life is supposed to function, but how each of us is even supposed to look, what's appropriate or inappropriate, right? For instance, you know, if you go to a very formal business setting and someone's in shorts and flip-flops and a tank top, you know, they're deviant right there, and they're not fitting into what the expectation is. So something like gender expectations is something we take for granted. You know, we, unless you're one who's challenging these gender expectations, you may not be aware of, you know, the depth that, you know, that or the value that people put on it, the depth of meaning and all of that. So anyway, that's the point, bringing now that up with whenever we code masculinity or femininity in terms of clothing. For the most part in society, sexuality and gender get lumped together. That's something that we in this course have cleared up. We've talked about it before. It's not the same thing, right? Just because someone might challenge gender expectations doesn't necessarily mean that their sexuality lines up with those expectations, right? Or that their sexuality, actually what I should be saying is that their sexuality is connected in any way to their gender expression, right? So when we talk about, you know, gender, we separate sex, that's the biological, okay? The physical characteristics that a person has, you know, it's debatable, right? We use a very open definition for our course, but it's debatable whether a person can, if it's only a person born into that sex, can they be that sex, or whether they can achieve it through, you know, surgical or, you know, other means, medical means, right? But that's just physical characteristics, that's sex, right? Gender, right, is what we consider, you know, male or female, well, masculine or feminine, right? It's about behavior, it's about expectations. A person born a woman can adopt a masculine gender or vice versa, right? Most people don't really think about it or see it as abnormal because, again, we're socialized from a very early age to conform to these gender expectations, so they seem natural, but they're really, you know, nothing about our culture is natural, and gender is all about culture, right? You know, that's one of the major points in sociology, right? People, you know, through social reproduction, through the institutionalizing or institutionalization of norms, values, beliefs, right, across time, you know, we produce these expectations, right? And we, you know, and there's, you know, the influence is very strong again. You know, that's kind of one of the points. It's like, it's so strong, it seems natural, right? It's only when we investigate it that it's not natural. But having said that, gender and sexuality are always linked together. I mean, even in some of the videos that we've shared, and this is, I'm assuming why this question came up is, you know, whether, you know, a person is gay because of their gender, right? I mean, that's kind of with the social, you know, it's heteronormativity, right? You know, the expectation is that people are heterosexual, and then, you know, if they conform to the expected genders, they're probably conforming to the same expectations regarding sexuality. But since we use gender to kind of code each other, to make sense of whether someone's male or female, you know, that gets dragged along with it. But just in terms of trying to understand it, it's not the same thing. So just because, again, someone is violating, or in one way to think about violating gender norms or challenging gender norms, right, doesn't necessarily mean anything about their sexuality. They may be heterosexual, homosexual, pansexual, asexual, gender doesn't suggest that, although, you know, it does get lumped together, and there's a strong association in society with, in general in society, right? In general, association that if a person's gender is this, like if they're feminine, they must be attracted to men, right? Or if a person's gender is masculine, then therefore they must be attracted to women, or what is feminine, right? So in terms of transgender, you know, this is someone who, you know, might challenge gender expectations, gender norms, or maybe has transcended, gender expectations, right? So I hope that helps clarify it. I know when some of you wrote about it in our papers, we weren't talking about sexuality, you know, but some of you chose to write about it, but it's okay. But again, just know that that's when we talk about gender, that's what we're talking about. But we'll clarify it even further in about 2 weeks when we start discussing our chapter on gender, right? At that point, we might not spend so much on culture, but we'll spend more on some of the issues with regarding inequality based on gender and sex, you know, how, when we talk about the pay gap and things like that. That's just one position, you know, separating all these three categories, sex, gender, and sexuality. Joshua writes in, how does making something illegal make the market worse than something that is legal, right? So very broad question. I don't really recall off the top of my head how we framed it. I think it was with the emerging legalization of some drugs, or maybe we talked about prohibition. But one of the arguments made whenever there's a clandestine economy is that because it's hidden, it's not regulated, a lot more of a person's, a person might be violated more because they can't, you know, for instance, they can't use the apparatuses or means that are usually available to folks who, you know, might be, like, say, a victim of crime, but not participating in kind of illegal activity. Now, let me clear it up. But this is one of the reasons. It's usually with crime, right? So, for instance, we know that people who participate in criminal activity have a high probability of being victimized by crime themselves. Like, for instance, we know that people who deal drugs often get robbed. But again, you know, if one is a drug dealer, who do they go to for help or for justice, right? They can't go to the police. That's just one example. Now, it's not the best example on why to make something illegal. Probably the best example is, and it's controversial, but this is one of the arguments that's out there, is with sex work. So sex work often, makes people who participate in it very vulnerable. Sometimes folks are forced into it, okay? Especially, you know, if they're children, you know, they're probably forced into it. The same thing with women who are, who don't originate in this country, or even men and women, right? But the point is that it's a clandestine economy. So when sex workers who are participating on the illegal side of it are attacked, robbed, or sexually assaulted, there's usually no recourse for them, right? Especially, you know, even if they might be captive, they might be slaves. So the argument is that if it were to be regulated and legalized to a certain extent, or even decriminalized, right? One of the things that would emerge is that more people would seek out, you know, the state or police or get help when they needed it, right? If it's regulated, then, you know, the authorities could, you know, there's less hiding of it. So, you know, the idea is that you then can focus on those who are probably the worst element inside that industry, if that's making sense, right? For instance, I'm trying to recall something that just came, you know, I just thought of, but it might be in LA County, but I'm not too sure. Don't quote me on it. But I know for underage, in some areas, the push is for underage boys and girls who are, you know, for minors who are in the sex industry, or, you know, one of the things that they're trying to do is to decriminalize it so that they can help them not only find justice, but to get out of that type of economy. Now, having said that, well, you know, arguably, well, maybe we'll just leave it like that. I was going to argue the other part that, and I guess I'll just throw it out there, that some sex workers are, you know, economically or financially pretty successful. So that's the other side. I mean, whenever we talk about sex work, theoretically, it's a very broad spectrum. You have on one side the poor, usually minority women and men who are often victimized, who are, you know, who have a higher likelihood of being exposed to drugs, violence, and other ills in society, who don't make very much, right? You know, here locally in Los Angeles, you know, they're kind of concentrated in, you know, South LA on certain streets, things like that. And it always moves around depending on how it's prosecuted or how law enforcement, you know, pressures a certain area. And but the other side is that, you know, there are some men and women who are in this industry that make thousands of dollars for their services, you know, or for a single act or, you know, a day's work, if you want to frame it. If you know about like Elliot Spitzer, you know, when the allegations, well, when the facts that he was, purchasing sex from a escort came about, you know, we found, you know, one of the things that was revealed that it's like he's spending thousands of dollars for a weekend or something like that. But that's the point. And to kind of just chime in a little bit again on why making something legal might help it. You know, right now, a lot of, you know, sex work is online forms, things like that facilitate it. You know, just recently, like 2-3 weeks ago, I think the Justice Department, you know, arrested and charged the CEO of Backpage, you know, with trafficking, I think. I'd have to clarify it, or you can clarify it, but that did make the news, and people, you know, began talking about it because, you know, the argument is that this organization profited from and facilitated an illegal activity. But a very complex discussion whenever we talk about these things, right? Just to kind of throw another thing out. Well, I will just leave it like that. I guess one more. Grace writes in, since bureaucracies treat people like numbers, what might be the more productive and humane way to structure an organization? Some folks argue that, and this is something we don't really, you know, talk about it, but some folks argue that maybe more horizontal, you know, structures might be better, where people have equal share and equal power and authority within an organization. Not too many out there that we can point to. Even some of, you know, maybe collectives, things like that are good examples, but even some collectives incorporate some elements of the bureaucracy. Now, having said that, I'll play, I guess, an advocate for the other side. Having an impersonal system does have its benefits. For example, everyone gets treated, in theory, more equally, right? Like, for instance, if you go get services from a state organization and they tell you to take a number, you know, you're going to be served in, you know, in that order, right? Whether you're rich or you're poor, because you're treated as a number, there's arguably more equality there, or it's more efficient because you're not dealing with someone's personal status or anything like that. You know, you just try to process people as quickly and efficiently as possible. But I mean, again, when we talk about the bureaucracy, there's pros and cons to it. An impersonal world is something that we're surrounded by, but one of the things that we have to keep in mind is, you know, there's reasons for it, right? Since we're going to talk about our economy, you know, treating, you know, no, people don't want to be treated as a number, but like if you're in a position of power, you know, well, I guess maybe that's not a good example to defend the bureaucracy. I was going to say, if people are treated as a number and you're in a position where you have to make a decision like laying off 1,000 people or, filing, you know, bankruptcy on behalf of the company, right? It's a lot easier to just see those people as numbers. We'll get more into that. You know, that's one of the sides of, you know, of our economic system that a lot of folks don't like to think about. But I mean, again, sometimes people, you know, it can be very impersonal, but we'll get to that as we move forward. But let's talk about stratification. So let me throw a definition out there for you. This is social stratification. We're mostly going to focus on our class system, but before we get to that, we're going to, you know, kind of identify what social stratification is, some of the other forms that have existed, and how our modern system works. So social stratification is a structuring of inequalities between groups in society in terms of their access to material and symbolic rewards. While all societies involve some form of stratification, only with the developed and state-based systems did wide differences in wealth or money and material possession held by an individual or group and power arise. In larger traditional societies and in industrialized countries today, there is stratifications in terms of wealth, property, and access to material goods and cultural products. Now, whenever we talk about stratification in general, it just means separating things into layers. Like if you think about our Earth and you're familiar with how it's structured, the Earth is stratified. It has a core, a mantle, all the way up to the crust, right? There's different layers. Same thing with like a 7-layer bean dip. That's stratified too, right? Different layers. Each layer looks a little bit different, acts a little bit different. So when we talk about our society, right, in terms of stratification, we're mostly going to talk about class, right? If you're lower class or poor, you know, your opportunities, the way you live, is going to be different from those who are in the upper portions, right? We'll talk about the middle class and what it means and what it is. However, before we get to that, we'll cover the other two types of class systems just very briefly. Slavery system and caste system, okay? So these first two are largely dependent on legal and religious sanctions of sanctioned inequalities, right? They're culturally recognized and, if we look at the caste system in India, it can be practiced for hundreds of years. Something in Europe that, you know, Europe had a caste system at one time. When we look at feudalism, people were born serfs, or they were born into the elite classes, right? if they were born into elite classes, they, you know, could hold property, they had power, etc. Now, before we go further, I want to share with you a video, and we'll talk about all these things together, about African Americans and the cotton economy and slavery. Now, slavery was in the United States a caste system. People were born into slavery, and that characterized their life from there on. Some people could escape slavery and become their own person and experience mobility upwards, but for the most part in the South, people who were born slaves died slaves. Their children born into slavery became slaves, right? And it was based on, you know, for the most part, the color of their skin, right? And there was a clear separation of, economic, not only resources, but cultural and social opportunities, okay? So anyway, one thing we want to look at is the cotton economy and slavery and how it's linked to our economy today. So let's watch this really briefly. It's from the African American series on PBS. It's called The Cotton Economy and Slavery. It's about 3 minutes long. So let's watch this and we'll be right back.
What made cotton so desirable? A perfect storm. In the 1790s, America's oldest crops like tobacco were depleting farmland and dropping in value. At the same time, the textile industry in Great Britain was exploding, creating enormous international demand for cotton clothing. Eli Whitney's gin merely provided the motor for a global economic machine, and slavery was its fuel.
Everybody was getting a piece of it. All these northern bankers and marketing people, folks who owned the ships that transported the cotton, everybody was getting a piece of the pie.
Cotton utterly transformed the United States, making fertile land from Georgia to Texas extraordinarily valuable. The fact that Native Americans lived on these lands was a temporary inconvenience, solved by a policy of Indian removal. The massive replacement of native populations with slave plantations. It's a part of our troubled history that can still be seen from the air.
If we were flying over this prior to European settlement, we would have seen large fields of corn and beans, trees and squash. When the first English began moving in here, they began chopping down the trees and expanding the fields available for cotton.
The enormous profitability of cotton undermined the principles of the American Revolution and forever altered black life. The more money the planters made from growing cotton, the more cotton the planters wanted to grow, and that took more slaves. Slaves in the Upper South became incredibly more valuable as commodities because of this demand for them in the Deep South. They were sold off in droves, and that created a second middle passage. And in many ways, the second middle passage was just as devastating as the first. To feed King Cotton, more than 1 million African Americans were carried off into the Deep South. That's 2.5 times the number that were brought to the United States from Africa. It was the largest forced migration in American history.
Welcome back. Again, that's from the series, The African Americans. I think it's available on your Canopy account. You can go ahead and check that if you want or are interested. It's a multi-part series. But our point here, why we bring it up, is that it's a good demonstration of the opportunities that, slavery gave some and the constraints that it placed on others, either physical or social, right? Even though a lot of folks prospered, you know, only certain folks were able to prosper, you know, some of those ratifications arguably are still felt by either by large numbers of the population. These consequences for some were negative and for some were positive, right? Anyhow, the point is that, you know, slavery was a system of stratification, a sort of caste system. But traditionally, when we talk about the caste system, we look at India. People born into a certain caste, you know, had certain opportunities, certain expectations. And even today, although the caste system isn't reinforced by the state, it still has a lot of cultural value for some. Those who, for instance, come from the Dalit or the lowest class, you know, some of them are extremely wealthy now or have some wealth, but they still deal with this stigma that was connected to the caste system that was practiced for so long. Anyhow, moving forward, the stratification system in our country, you know, we refer to as a class system, right? And again, with all stratification systems, not only our own, they shape aspects of our social life, not only income, wealth, but education, occupation, class, and lifestyle, how we live. Classes derive from inequality in possession and control of material resources and access to educational and occupational opportunities. An individual's class position is, again, partially achieved, right? That is inscribed. It's, you know, it's not set in stone, but one of the things that we talked about is that because you're born into families, like part of your family's history is your own history. So if you're born into wealth, there's a good chance you will be wealthy, right? Depending on the amount of wealth that you know, you're born into, whether it's because of the opportunities you might have because of that wealth, or maybe even something more straightforward, because of inheritance, right? That does determine a person's life chances. We'll talk about life chances as we go. If you're born poor, can you become rich? Yes, but it's very, very difficult, right? You know, chances are, and we're talking about probabilities, if you're from the lower class, you have a higher probability of staying there, okay? And it's, again, it's often linked to opportunity, to things like that. Now, one of the things as we move forward, we'll look, you know, think about education. A lot of folks call it the great equalizer, but even in education, there's a lot of inequality, right? We won't touch on all of it today. If anything, we'll really talk about, you know, we'll talk about it when we get to our chapter on education. But for instance, if your parents are educated, chances are they have, and this is probability, right? Chances are they have good jobs, so they have a stream of income, some wealth, and most importantly, like, not only materially, but even culturally, right? There's sets of expectations, there's opportunities. One way I like to frame it is when I ask my classes about when they potentially have children. If they need help with, say, math, right? Like, at what point will you need, at one point might you not be able to help them, right? Like, is it when they get to algebra, you know, geometry, statistics, trigonometry, calculus, right? At what point, you know, do you have to find another solution, right? And, you know, right there, you know, if you do well in math, you know, you could find a gainful career in one of the sciences. But again, you know, if you can only help your child up into algebra, whether it's because you don't remember it or never learned it, right? If you have some wealth, if you have access, you can hire a tutor. If you can do it yourself, that's even better, right? But if you don't and you can't hire a tutor, right? The probability of that child succeeding becomes, in math becomes a lot smaller, right? Could they still do it? Yes, right? Maybe they have a great teacher, or maybe they're able to figure it out. One of the things that people hope is that things like the internet, through services like Khan Academy, or just people going online and showing others how to do it through YouTube or something like that, will help level that playing field, okay? But essentially in the class system, again, the playing field isn't level, right? So anyway, let's define class again. This is a large group of people who hold similar material prosperity and power. And I just use this term, and it's a term we'll keep using throughout this lecture. Life chances, a person's opportunity to achieve economic prosperity. And like we just mentioned before, a person's class position is both ascribed and achieved. It's influenced by factors that they have no control over. This is ascribed, whether they're born into wealth, race, gender, and ethnicity does play a role in it, but it also is influenced by things that are achieved or things that people have the ability to influence, that their agency produces, right? Like, for instance, a person can study really hard, or it doesn't even have to be hard, or we're not, we can even talk about just like going to school, getting grades, going to college. That's all something a person has the ability to do. Or when a person graduates, either to, choosing the discipline that they go into, or how they invest their money, or the choices that they make when they buy or they choose not to buy things, right? That's all achieved. So it's a mix, right? Now, one of the issues, I guess, that always comes up in, when we talk about this, is that we often forget about this ascribed part, right? When we look at either people who are rich or people who are poor, the assumption is that they did it all themselves. Like, for instance, we won't talk about his politics, but someone who is wealthy and has a lot of, attention on him, right, is Donald Trump. But Donald Trump, was born into an affluent family. And I'm not like demonizing him for it, but we have to understand that, to a certain extent, he had some opportunities. He was able to, parlay that into his own success, right? One of the things that we know is that, just because people are born into wealth doesn't necessarily mean that they'll be wealthy, right? If it's first generation, there's a higher probability. If it's second generation, third, it goes down. Okay, maybe you heard the term of new money and old money. That's kind of why that idea perpetuates, because, some new money doesn't last, right? Usually because of, a number of factors. So, beyond that, it's just speculation. The other side of it is that you do have people who are wealthy who, started from nothing. Even though it gets lumped into this idea of like the Horatio Alger myth, there are people who do it, but the point is that it's very difficult. It's, if we're looking at, placing bets on people, it's, most of these bets were, are highly improbable, or there's a lot, the way I like to explain is that there's a lot that has to go right, with things that you have control over and things that you don't have control over, for a person to go from, from poverty all the way to rich. But really what mostly affects people is from one class to another, right? If you're poor, to move into the middle class. And if you're middle class, to move into the upper class, or at the very least stay middle class, right? Anyway, we'll talk about that as we move forward. However, one thing I want to do next is share with you a short video, a video, right? It's about eight minutes or so, but 8-9 minutes or so. But it's from a few years ago. It was produced right after the economic collapse in 2008. And it's illustrating how our economy, well, how our class system looks, how wealth is distributed in our society, and what some of the consequences of that are. So we'll watch this and then we'll be right back. But this is a video called Land of the Free, Home of the Poor, right? And we'll clarify some of the ideas that are presented here. The one thing, we'll talk about it later. When we connect it to theory, there's two theories here that are presented. One presented more than the other. But anyhow, we'll watch this and then we'll be right back.
Near Times Square, at the line for late show tickets, we borrowed David Letterman's audience for a short quiz on economic inequality.
So this is three different societies.
Uh-huh.
It's the distribution of wealth in the societies. Where do you think these three places are?
In each chart, we explained, yellow represents the richest fifth of the population, blue the second richest, and so on down to orange, the poorest fifth. Which chart, we asked, represents the distribution of wealth in the United States?
So this one's exactly equally distributed from the top to the bottom.
In the first chart, each one-fifth of the population has 20% of the wealth. In the middle pie chart, a middling amount of inequality. The richest fifth owns 36%, the poorest fifth only 11%. And in the third chart, extreme inequality, where the richest fifth owns 84% of the nation's wealth, while the bottom two-fifths, 40% of the population, owns an almost invisible 0.3% of the nation's property.
Which one do you think the United States is?
I might say this one.
You think the United States is completely equal, 20%, 20%?
Not exactly equal, but that might be my guess, that that'd be the closest. Or maybe this one, it's one of the top two.
And you?
Maybe the middle.
What? The United States would be the middle?
I think the middle is U.S.
Middle one is U.S. Middle one is U.S. Middle one is U.S. Which one would you think the U.S. was?
Hopefully that.
This would have to be third world. This would have to be places like India.
A place that would be incredibly unequal, right?
Yeah.
Definitely. The U.S. would be here.
U.S. would be here, and this one?
I don't think that exists.
At least he got that one right. The completely equal pie economy is completely made up. The middle pie represents the wealth distribution of Sweden. The bottom pie? We asked two presumably low-income workers near the tourist line for Letterman.
What place would have a distribution like this? What
United States.
United States.
Yes, this chart represents the land of opportunity, ours.
The study had a few different parts to it.
Psychologist Dan Ariely designed the quiz. First, consistent finding, most Americans don't realize how unequal our country really is.
People don't understand how much wealth the top 20% have. They actually have 84% of the wealth and they think they have much less. And more disturbingly, people don't understand how little wealth the bottom of the distribution have. The bottom 40% of the US have about 0.3% of the wealth, basically zero, and people think they have much more than that.
But how can that be, given the spread of McMansions and luxury brands in America's wealthy communities, so easy to contrast with almost any poor neighborhood in the country? Harvard Business School professor David Moss.
People look around them at their local communities, and local communities tend to be more equal than the broader society. And so as they look around, that's essentially their judgment, or our judgment. I should include myself, see the same thing.
So there isn't that much inequality in Newton, Massachusetts, where you live, for example.
Much less than in the society as a whole.
Maddie McWilliams, who attends high school in upscale Newton, agrees.
It's getting easier for people to ignore the inequality. They can stay far away from it.
Insulate themselves.
Yeah, I think so.
Another reason people don't realize the extent of inequality, most of it is explained by gains at the tippy top, Harvard economist Richard Freeman.
In the last 30 years or so, the share of national income that has gone to the upper 0.1%, not to the upper 1%, 0.1%, rose by 10 percentage points. That is one of the most astounding patterns I've ever seen in data.
0.1%.
0.1%, yes. People sometimes say, oh, the rich, it's the upper 10%. It's the upper 5%. No, no. This is the 0.1%. Warren Buffett has this wonderful statement where he says, yes, there's been a class war in the United States, and my class, namely the super rich people, have won.
A graphic recent example, this New York Times online slideshow of children's playhouses, which can cost up to $250,000. Meanwhile, more and more Americans, millions of them, can't afford their own homes.
My house is in foreclosure. I owe them at least $100,000 more than my house is worth, probably closer to $150,000 more than my house is worth.
Are they coming to take it away?
At some point they will. They haven't yet, but at some point they will.
And then where will you go?
I have no idea. I try not to think about it because I really have no idea.
Denise Barrent has a college degree from Lehigh University, some master's level courses, and a paralegal certificate. She once had a job at a health insurance company paying $80,000 a year, plus a part-time job just for fun, she says, selling clothes at Talbot's. But for 3 years, she's been unemployed, free-falling out of the middle class and into poverty, living in a well-to-do Boston suburb she could once afford.
Even the organizations that were helping people before have been stretched so much that they are having a hard time helping people.
You mean it's hard for you to find a food pantry?
There's one the next town over. And it was funny, I remember the first time I went, the people were like, well, you don't look like you should be here.
Don't have a lot of college grads like yourself at the food pantry.
I'm sure they didn't at the beginning, but I'm sure they do now.
Barron's situation has deteriorated since we first interviewed her earlier this year, and she said this.
The top 1% is living well, and they don't get it.
One of her fellow interviewees was security guard Bobby Hicks.
15 years ago, I was working as an office products delivery truck driver.
And you were doing better doing that than you are now?
Yes, absolutely.
Though Hicks was born in America, Christy Pierre-Louis in Haiti, her job frustration echoes his.
It makes me feel like the American dream is not just, it's not for me. It's just not for me. It maybe is for the wealthy, just not for me. Because it doesn't matter how I reach, you know, I'm reaching out my hand and it seems like it's still, I'm still just very far away from it. It's like someone literally pulling it as, you know, as much as I'm running after it, they're running away with it. And I don't get my piece of the American dream because I work hard in this country too. I pay my taxes just like everyone else. I work here, I go to school, and I'm doing my best, but still my best is just not good enough.
So the U.S. looks unequal to a Haitian? Economist Richard Freeman is not surprised.
We're high for a poor country in terms of inequality, and we're a rich country. We're about the same level of inequality as China. And of course, China, half the population are rural peasants, are not part of the modern world. And if we were to compare us with African countries, dictators in different places, you know, taking a lot of the wealth from normal people, we would be among the top half of the African countries of inequality. So the U.S. really is reached an extraordinary level of income inequality.
The luxury goods speak for themselves. But who knew that the kids of the wealthy were flying private jets to camp this summer? Okay, to some, this might be cause for indignation. But to others, it's not that simple.
Inequality is the flip side of providing powerful incentives for people who generate a lot of income.
Economist Stephen Davis.
Part of the success of the United States economy lies in the fact that if you succeed in a big way commercially, you're rewarded for that, and the taxes on your success are modest, say, compared to what they are in a country like France or in the Scandinavian countries.
But as Dan Ariely found in...
Okay, welcome back. So let's talk about that last point, and we'll kind of work backwards for a second. So this idea of powerful incentives is linked to the Davis-Moore theory. We'll talk about it again as we move forward. But that is one argument, right? Inequality is built into the system. That's what categorizes capitalism. It's not a system that's built on fairness to a certain extent, unless, you know, you think of fairness in terms of the rules of capitalism. So in that terms, yes, it is fair because inequality is part of the system, right? For those who have, according to like Davis-Moore theory and others, those who have better skills, who are smarter, more capable, have a chance of maximizing their potential and becoming wealthy, right? Or maintaining their wealth, right? This is the idea, right? For instance, if you start a business, you know, there's a lot of risks associated with it. But inside a capitalist system, you can, you can gain prosperity from it, right? Because of if you are successful, right? So that's an incentive. The other thing is, you know, for example, if we break down why some people get paid what they get paid, right? For instance, the Davis-Moore theory argues that those occupations that are important to society are the ones that we incentivize the most. So for instance, some of you might plan on becoming doctors, not only because of the prestige associated or occupational prestige associated with it, but also the potential gains that you might make from an income derived from that occupation. So, you know, in other words, the money that you might make, you know, over $100,000 or $150,000 a year starting, right, to become a medical doctor. Now, the incentive, that's the incentive. So, you know, if you think about how many years one might need to become a doctor, right? That's why we eventually get doctors, because if we, you know, the argument goes that if, you know, if you could be a fast food worker and make the same amount, everyone would go into fast food because you wouldn't need that kind of experience. You wouldn't need to sacrifice so much. Etc. But we know that fast food jobs don't nearly pay that much. In turn, we can think about why fast food gets a minimum wage, right? You know, it's arguably a job that someone can do with minimal skills in relation to the whole of society, right? So you just need to know how to do some, you know, you have to be literate and be able to follow directions. You don't need any college training, maybe just high school, if that. And that's one of the points, right? We'll talk about this further because the other side is, something that we might kind of use a Marxist analysis to kind of look at. And again, when we use a Marxist analysis, it's not about revolution or anything like that. It's about understanding how capitalism works and being able to critique it and using the relationships that people have to the means of production as the primary kind of pivot point. That's where we start off and that's where we kind of look at everything. Like for instance, when we talk about production, you know, those who buy labor, someone who owns a company, will make money off the labor of others. Right? They're able to do so because they own the means of production, like whether it's a hospital, right, or a bank or a fast food restaurant, right? buying labor in turn is used to make a profit, and if successful, they keep that surplus value, that profit. But we'll get to that in a second. What we want to talk about, though, is how social inequalities result from patterns inside the social structure. We'll introduce some terms now. Social mobility, the movement of individuals or groups between different positions, social positions. Intergenerational mobility, movement up and down social stratification hierarchies from one generation to the other. Intragenerational movement and mobility, movement up and down the social stratification hierarchy within the course of a personal career, right? So these are different types of, you know, ways we can move, like from one generation to the other. And for parents, you know, this is always the hope that their children would move up in terms of social stratification and not move down. Okay. Intergenerational, this is what individuals aspire to, right? If you're lower class, you want to be middle or upper. If you're middle class, you want to be upper, right? If you're upper class, maybe you want to become elite, right? Etc. Now, when we think about structural mobility, this is mobility resulting from changes in the number and kinds of jobs available in society. And this is, you know, what most people are pointing to, especially it's become a topic inside our, you know, inside the elections. I try not to talk about the elections, you know, it's appropriate, but if we talk about politics, it's not something that can be done easily in the kind of format that we're using here. So that's why I avoid it. But having said that, you know, it's a big concern for both parties, all parties, you know. They don't call it structural mobility, but that's really what they're pointing to, right? When we talk about the economy, the types of jobs out there, and whether people can still be prosperous, you know, this is about the potential for structural mobility, positive structural mobility. And it's always, you know, linked to, you know, jobs, because that's for the most part how people, make the money that they need to survive. And when we talk about income, right, it's usually either, again, derived from a job or derived from property or investments. Like if you have stock and you get dividends, right, or you make money off your investment, you know, or you lend someone money and they pay you back with interest, that's, you know, that's income, right? Wealth is owning something. So when we looked at that video, you know, we saw the distribution of wealth, you know, and the distribution of income is kind of the same. But wealth is really what kind of separates classes, what people own. And to a certain extent, it can be distorted. Like a person can have a house and they can say they own their house, but unless that house is paid off for, it's not really fully wealth, right? Like one of the problems in the video that the woman had who was in foreclosure is that her house was worth less than what she owed. A lot of folks after the 2008 economic crisis were in the same position, right? Up until that point, you know, there was this myth, if you will, that kind of motivated a lot of people, unfortunately, to buy homes and it kind of inflated the prices, right? More than they needed to be, because the whole idea is that if you qualify for one of these, loans that were, what's a good way to put it, subprime, these subprime loans, right? Whenever something's subprime is usually because the person who's borrowing is more of a risk, right? For instance, you know, if you have bad credit, you know, you might get a subprime loan for a home, a car, whatever you're borrowing for, but these subprime loans, right? But the whole idea is that you could lend to someone with poor credit or without the necessary stream of income or without any collateral, right? Because the housing market was so hot, people were convinced that they were fools if they didn't jump in, right? You know, you bought a house 1 year for $300,000, and then next year or in a couple months it was worth $50,000 more, or maybe in a year $100,000 more. So people, when they were joining at the back end of it, right, you know, they thought, well, I could buy this house for $450,000, and then when if there's ever a time when I can't afford it, I'll sell it, and I'll sell it for a profit. So this is kind of the myth that was perpetuated in the system, and it only kind of added gasoline, if you will, to that fire. And eventually what happened is that housing got to a point where people couldn't afford the to buy them or to pay for the their mortgage payment. I mean, it gets really complicated because it's the type of interest rates that they were subjected to, or that they had agreed upon, right? After a certain amount of time, the interest rates increased, so their payments increased, so they couldn't afford it. So, a lot of people who took out these loans around the same time, they all matured, the interest rates matured at the same time. All their interest rates went up, their costs went up, they had to pay more, they couldn't afford it. So you had people going back in, trying to sell their homes, but then less people being able to buy them. Or, you know, that's when the market peaked and it started going down. And you have people who, again, unfortunately, like this woman who, owed more money than her house was worth, right? And it's a problem too, you know, for middle class and upper middle class, most people's wealth is tied into their home. So if there's not a vehicle where they can, or if they don't have the opportunity to sell their home, right? And this is a concern, like, can they retire, okay? Can they use that wealth to the benefit of their children, right? I don't know. I mean, one of the ways I think this perspective has to change is that, you know, homes shouldn't really be looked as an investment. You know, they're really not, well, I mean, real estate's okay, but you can't really live, you know, on your investment and really call it an investment. Because if you ever have to, if you ever sell your home and move, you have to be able to afford somewhere else, right? Anyway, and for most people, that's not the case, right? You know, but having said that, the middle class is shrinking. So one thing I want to show you next is a short little video on the shrinking middle class, okay? And this is important, right? You know, like, we don't really have the time to get into all the functions, but we do see that the economy is getting stronger in some respects. My fear is that it's becoming bifurcated, right? But anyway, one way we can see this bifurcation is with the shrinking middle. Either people are upper class or lower class. There's no in between. And the in between was kind of the healthy part of the economy, right? In order for, like, capitalism to keep working, for instance, it needs consumption. And homes are tied into this consumption, not only because people buy homes and, you know, it becomes a form of a way to invest, but whenever people buy homes, you know, they buy new furniture, they buy new appliances, they buy a bunch of stuff. People buy stuff for them, so they start families, right?
We've spent much time this year.
So when we think about terms in terms of consumption, right, it really spurs consumption, right? So, I mean, with rising, you know, housing prices are, you know, back up, you know, I'm not a speculator or anything like that, so I won't tell you, you know, what I really think about the valuations, but, you know, that has led to some, you know, more confidence in the economy. But at the same time, we know that people aren't spending as much as they used to. So, they're having trouble making ends meet. So without further delay, we'll watch this short video. There's less of a middle class than there once was. This is contributing to income inequality, and it's growing. So let's watch this, and we'll be right back.
Spent much time this year talking about the travails of the middle class. Now, a new analysis shows how it's shrinking in most U.S. metro areas. From Boston to Goldsboro, North Carolina, to Midland, Texas, to Seattle, there are fewer adults living in middle-class households across the country than there were in 2000. The analysis by the Pew Research Center found that in 160 metro areas, there was an increase of lower-income households. And 172 metro areas saw a rise in upper-income households. This year, we're teaming up with American Public Media's Marketplace and PBS's Frontline on how economic forces are affecting Americans. It's called How the Deck is Stacked. And the host of Marketplace, Kai Rizdahl, joins us again. Kai, just so we're all on the same page, who is really middle class versus who thinks they're middle class?
So for the purposes of this study, Hari, it goes like this. Anybody making from two-thirds to twice the median income in this country. So it's about $47,000 to about $125,000 if you want to run the numbers.
So those are the folks that are actually in the middle class. But we kind of feel that there are a lot of people in the middle class. A lot of people would want to self-identify as a member of the middle class. I'm the average Joe.
Right. That's what we are in this country, right? We are aspirational. We want inclusive prosperity. If you stopped 10 people on the street, probably seven of them would say, I am the middle class. And that's why this study matters, right? Because what happens in this economy is that the middle class drives it. The middle class are the consumers, right? The upper end are the investors, the lower end are getting by. The middle class are the consumers in this economy. And so what this study really says is, this is bad news for the future of economic growth in this country. And that's why it matters.
And as we pointed out, there were some places where the middle class got smaller because people got richer, and there were other places where the middle class got smaller because people got poorer. A couple of those different locations, examples?
Yeah, so there are some really good ones in this study. So if you look at Goldsboro, North Carolina, right? It used to be a railroad junction. It used to have a big Air Force base by it. It is an old economy town. It is a town that is seeing the economy go away from it. And right in that town, you see more people sliding from the middle class to the lower class. They're having a tougher time getting by. If you look at a place like Midland, Texas, which the Pew Research folks pulled out, Midland, Texas is an energy economy. The energy economy in the last 15 years in this country has been doing really well. And so people there are moving from the middle class to the upper class. It's not a zero-sum game, but this economy is changing, and that's what's driving this entire study and the fate of the middle class.
Now, we've heard of the middle class declining in rural areas. Is there a difference when we see that this is such a big deal in metro cities as well?
Well, the root of this study is income inequality, right? And we've known about it for a long time in the rural areas. It is now coming to these things called metropolitan statistical areas, these big centers of population, some big, some less big, where the bulk of the population in this country lives. Wages have been stagnant in this economy for decades now, right? Which means incomes and household wealth are stagnant, which means there is more income inequality. And when you have income inequality, you have more going to the low end, you have more going to the high end, and those drivers of prosperity in America are getting, as you said in the beginning, hollowed out.
So how does this square with the people that you've been talking to in the series you're working on as you report this?
So here's the thing. I'm going out into the field next week to talk to a couple that we first met in a coffee shop about 6 months ago here in downtown Los Angeles. They're both teachers. One of them has a master's degree. They are literally the epitome of the American middle class, right? You think if they can't make it on a teacher's salary, then something's up. Here's the deal. We were sitting there chatting over a cup of coffee and a piece of pie, and the husband said to me, "We've given up. We're done. We know we're never going to own a house. We're never going to grow beyond the middle class. We're buried in student debt. We don't really know if we're going to be able to afford to send our child to school." And they have given up. And that tells you what's at root in this study.
All right. Marketplace's Kai Rizdahl. Thanks so much.
You bet.
Welcome back. So again, just as a side note, Marketplace, we watch a lot of NewsHour. You know, those are good. I like those sources. I really like Marketplace. It's a radio show, but you can always podcast it and things like that. So a good plug for Marketplace. And, you know, they look at the economy and, you know, kind of educate folks who, you know, might not be used to terminology or understand all the different mechanisms that go in line with that. But anyway, having said that, the middle class is shrinking. This is something that we've known for some time. And again, it gets distorted, right? you know, I think the ones that are, you know, and I like to share this with our students because, you know, you're the ones that, you know, maybe 5, 10 years, maybe 15 years will be affected by it, probably, especially if it continues to grow, right? If you are successful, then, you know, you know, will have, you know, more opportunity. But if you're not, or less people have that middle, right, you could have a, like, you know, the teachers that were cited in this study, like, you know, you can have an education, but you're not able to really get those, you know, things that are associated with the American dream. And when we talk about the American dream, these are culturally shared goals, right? So like owning a home is a culturally shared goal. You know, and, you know, that's one of the things that has been, you know, is part of like maybe even the core of the, you know, this idea of the American dream. It becomes harder and harder, right? You know, so some people just get priced out. You know, that's the economy. I mean, when we think about economic forces shaping our life, you know, that's a good one right there. You know, like where you live, you know, where we live, it becomes segregated according to our income and wealth, right? If you live in a wealthy area, you know, chances are that, you know, most of the folks who are taking this class are young, so you probably don't own the homes that you live in, but your parents own them and they have some wealth, right? And if you wanted at least the same kind of life, you know, it's become difficult, right? It will become difficult because there's less opportunities, arguably, you know, than there were before. Or some people, you know, they, you know, their parents were middle class and they bought into an area. Now it's like upper class, right? The housing prices go up, right? But anyway, the point is that, you know, not only where we live, it's how we live, what we have access to. A lot of folks, when they buy homes, they look at the schools that are there, or, you know, the resources, or how safe the neighborhood is. You know, that's all tied to income. Now, we're going to kind of get a little bit more efficient here. Let's talk about poverty, right? There's two terms for poverty that we use. Absolute poverty, this is the minimum requirement necessary to sustain a healthy existence. This will be more relevant when we go to, when we talk about global inequality. Relative poverty is poverty defined according to the living standards of the majority in a given society. So in our society, you know, arguably in terms of like GDP and other economic indicators, wealthiest country in the world, extremely wealthy society, right? We have to think about relative poverty in terms of what people have and what people expect, right? Like, for instance, you know, we don't have as much absolute poverty, even though it does exist. But most of what we talk about when we talk about poverty is relative poverty. For instance, our poor have homes, but they might not own their homes, or they might live in conditions that aren't, considered. Well, I mean, there's a minimum standard, right? I mean, the point I'm trying to make is that, you know, most of the poor have shelter, right? They might have to share this shelter with others more than, you know, what is seen as culturally acceptable. What they eat, right? For instance, in our country, we don't have a issue with people, like a big issue with people starving to death, but we have issues, you know, related to malnutrition and some of the health outcomes that are associated with malnutrition, right? Same thing with education, right? You know, people get educated, but, you know, it's a type of education and opportunities that they have thereafter that we're looking at it. So when we talk about relative, like, I mean, sometimes you hear in like in the political debates, or some people have these perspectives where they say, well, The poor have refrigerators, they have TVs, yes, but at the same time, we have to think about, you know, our nation as setting certain standards, setting certain ability, I mean, you know, culturally shared goals and things like that, right? So that's what we're looking at. So when we talk about the poverty line, okay? Poverty line is the official government measure that defines those living in poverty in the United States. So in, you know, it's kind of in the, you know, if it's a single person, it's about the $11,000-$10,000 a year range. So it's not very high. And one of the problems with the poverty line is, well, let me first tell you, explain how the poverty line is used. It's used to determine benefits, right? Like if you're 100% or 120% over the poverty line, you know, 100% or under it, right? You might receive EBT benefits, like food benefits or shelter benefits, or for instance, I think, you know, part of this when you go off to college is used to figure out whether or not you'll get federal or state assistance. Again, this is the poverty line, right? The more dependents you have, the higher the household, you know, if you look at the chart behind us, the higher the income of that household goes up. So again, that's one of the things, like for example, in 2007, that's the number I have here, 20,650 annually, for a family of four was considered poor, right? Now, one of the things that critics of the poverty line often point to is that depending on where you live in the United States, $11,000, $12,000 a year, if you're a single person, you know, can vary radically, like in terms of what you have. Like for instance, if you live in the Midwest or in a rural area, rent isn't as expensive as say if you live in New York or Silicon Valley or even Los Angeles, right? In Los Angeles, someone might pay $1,000, $1,200, something like that, depending on the area, minimum, right? For a single bedroom, you know, apartment, or with, you know, the normal amenities that one would expect, like living room, bathroom, bedroom separated, right? We're not talking about like studio apartments where there's no walls or you just everything's in one big room anyway. But that's one of the critiques about the poverty line, right? It is adjusted a little bit for folks in Hawaii and Alaska. One of the reasons for that is that the poverty line is tied to consumables, right? Like some consumables like food and fuel, right? But doesn't really take too much into account as far as like rent and things like that. Arguably, some people, let's see. We have 10 minutes. I'm going to work a little backwards here. I'm going to talk about some of the theorists. We talk about Karl Marx in the text, the argument that the rich get richer, the capitalists and the proletariat or the working class. What's important about that is that, Marx really kind of underlined, what he calls the exploitation of, of others by the dominant class or people who own property. And again, the whole idea behind that is that the surplus value, this is the value that's generated by labor. It's what's sold at, you know, when it's sold, it's what generates the profit, isn't shared equally. And, you know, just to kind of look at it from a very capitalist point of view, that's kind of the point in capitalism. If you buy labor, right, that's how wealth is created for an individual, by buying the labor of others. Like the example I like to use is that if I give you a forest, like, and I ask you, how are you going to make money off this forest? You might say, well, I'm going to cut down the trees, right? It's a huge forest, right? So you cut down a tree, you use your own labor, and you sell the lumber. There's no exploitation there because you're keeping 100% of that surplus value. But if you really want to make a lot of money, right, you might hire people, right? And you're going to pay them a wage, but that wage isn't going to be equal in terms of the surplus value that's collected, right? You're going to pay them, you know, the motivation is really, and, you know, this is one of the critiques, to pay people as low a wage as you can get away with, right? Because the lowest wage you can get away with, the higher the surplus value, right? And you know, if you think about minimum wage, that's why we have a minimum wage, to keep that from happening, or to at least create a floor where competition doesn't drop below, right? Because otherwise you'd have a system where people keep undercutting each other. And you know, and that's one of the critiques of the clandestine labor market. But the only thing that I would say about the clandestine labor market is that if anything, those who are buying labor are the ones that are really propagating the issue. You know, people who work and need money will work, you know, based on how desperate they are, right? You know, you could think about, you know, just in general, like why some people choose to do the jobs that some of us might not even think of doing, not because of lack of creativity, but we wouldn't see ourselves doing it because it would either, I mean, I hate to use this term, but some people might categorize it as beneath us or not worth our time, right? You know, anyway, so that's something to kind of keep in mind as you read through the Marx writing. Weber, he expands on the understanding of power. And by doing that, you know, he goes beyond just class and talks about party and prestige. Besides the relationship of the means of production, class division depends on is dependent on skills, credentials, and social status. He talks about pariah groups who are prevented from opportunities, or groups that suffer from a negative status and discrimination. Once we get into race, we'll really expand on that. We know that, you know, because of a person's race, they experience or can experience positive or negative, you know, outcomes when it comes to their participation in the labor market in terms of discrimination. When we talk about discrimination, we'll clarify this. You know, discrimination can work to benefit someone, or and this is the most of the time when we talk about discrimination, it can serve to as an obstacle for someone, right? Just to kind of clarify it a little bit more, when we think about people's prejudice, right? These are pre-existing ideas. A person can have like a negative prejudice towards a person who, for instance, might be black or might be a certain race, might be Latino, and if they act on it, right, they might discriminate them and say, oh, well, I don't want to, you know, hire this person, or I'm going to lend to this person at a higher rate because of such and such stereotype. So in that, you know, they've been treated differently and in a way, in a context that's negative. Ways, you know, prejudice can work positively towards people is that, for instance, and this is one of the things, like, when we think about white as a race, or even, you know, let's just stick at white as a race, because it works a number of ways, and then we can talk about the color line too. But white as a race doesn't have a lot of negative prejudices, right? If anything, has positive, you know, positive ideas associated with it. For instance, you know, the only negative stereotypes that, you know, if I ask you, oh, what are some negative stereotypes about white folks, right? Some of the negative stereotypes are ones that, you know, in certain situations can serve as a, you know, can serve as a negative, you know, can have negative consequences. But for the most part, where it really matters, these negative stereotypes don't really exist. Like, for instance, negative stereotype might be like white people can't dance, right? If you're a white dancer, you might experience discrimination because of that preconceived idea, right? But for the most part, if we think about the negative stereotypes associated with people of other races, you know, they don't have the same effect that they might have in economic realms. Like, this whiteness doesn't have the same negative consequences when it comes to the economy. If anything, it has positive ones, right? Like, this idea of trustworthiness, right? You never really question a person's trustworthiness if they're white based on their skin color, but some people might do it because of their prejudice and question a person who might be Asian, black, or Latino, if that's making sense. But if not, we'll clarify. And again, we talked about the Davis-Moore theory. Stratification is functional. It has a purpose in our society. So, I mean, some people want to eradicate poverty, but the question is, like, you can't really, you know, well, the truth is you can't really do it without getting rid of capitalism, right? You can, you can control it or have it, not go below a certain standard. And when we talk about poverty lines and social programs, that's kind of what we're looking at, because it's a function, right? Like, for instance, poverty motivates people to go to school, to work hard, things like that, right? That's one of the arguments. It rewards people who are successful, okay? It motivates people, right? For instance, Marx talks about it, this motivation too, but he talks about it in terms of slavery, but or in terms of controlling a person's agency. But, people go to work because they need money to survive. They need money to buy nice things if they have excess income, right? And that's one of the things about our society, right? You could argue that we have a lot of things that are excessive, like we don't really need TVs or things like that, but the same thing, it's cultural, right? So maybe we do need TVs and nice cars and refrigerators, but that's kind of a deeper discussion for another time. But anyway, just going back to stratification is functional. Even poverty can have a function. You can think about all the jobs that are created because poverty exists, like whether it's someone who works for, the Social Security program or welfare office or, social workers, things like that, right? These are jobs that are created because poverty exists, right? If poverty was eliminated overnight, right, these jobs would cease to exist. The other thing, it creates a pool of labor, right? Since there's competition, we try to get occupations that there's less people competing, and we get rewarded a little better than others. But that's it for today. We've run out of time. Thank you, and see you next week. Bye-bye.